My pleasure to introduce this week's artificial intelligence guest speaker, Sumit, Gulwani. Sumit got his PhD at UC Berkeley and now runs a group at Microsoft Research working on techniques for automated programming. It's happy to see people both from the AI community and the programming language software community here, since naturally his work spans it. And without further ado, I won't go into the many accomplishments, both publications and actually fielding working software. It's a neat stuff, but hopefully he'll clue us in during this talk.
Okay, thanks, Dan, for the introduction. Thanks for inviting me here. It's a pleasure. So I'm going to be talking about programming by examples today. This is a joint work with many collaborators, including colleagues at MSR and lots of interns. And I would especially like to call out Alex, who is a integral member of the team. And Maxim here also interned with us for 6 months. So whatever I'm going to be describing today, I recently got an opportunity to write an article, and you can actually find this off my webpage. So there are three key messages that I would like to actually leave you with in this talk today. So one is that I would actually like to focus on a killer application for programming by examples, and this is what I believe is in the area of so-called data wrangling. This is an activity where data scientists typically end up spending 80% of their time when they try to convert data from raw semi-structured format to something much more structured that is more easy to analyze further. And in fact, if you think about people who do not know programming, then they have to do all these repetitive mundane tasks by hand, which is very error prone and time consuming. So the other point that I would like to focus on is that of how do you deal with ambiguities in examples. So examples are a form of under-specification, and we need to have proper systems in order to resolve this ambiguity. And then I will focus on algorithms for translating examples into programs. So I work in the programming languages field, and the traditional customer for our community has been that of a software developer. But today, it turns out that there's a huge opportunity for programming languages research if we specifically consider that 99% of people who own computers today, they are non-programmers, and I will also call them end users in my talk today. These people struggle with simple repetitive tasks, and they would typically like to write a 10-line program in order to help them automate the tasks that they are struggling with. But this is something that they cannot do because they do not have a programming background. And I think programming by examples can play a significant role in making these people much more productive in their daily lives. And this field of programming by examples, I think, is a cross-disciplinary field. In order to build good end-to-end systems, we not only need contributions from programming languages, but you'll also notice that there are opportunities for machine learning algorithms and HCI approaches to also play a big role. So what are these people actually trying to do, these 99% of people who have access to computers and who do not know programming? So in order to figure this out, I started studying help forums, and I specifically looked at spreadsheet help forums, since spreadsheets are the most commonly used software in the world. And here is a typical interaction that I noticed. So an end user on the help forum will request an expert to give them a program that can convert this input string on the left side of the arrow to this output string on the right side of the arrow. The expert would look at this input-output pair and possibly conjecture in this particular case that the user wants to extract two characters starting from the fifth one, and that's the program that they will send back to the user who asked for it. The user would take that program, run it on their spreadsheet, the rest of the data in their spreadsheet, and figure out that it does not do the right job on some other input. And that's another example then they will send to the expert. So the expert would look at it and then try to understand what is it that the user is trying to do. So what do you think is the user trying to do here? Exactly. And do you know how to program this task in Excel?
Absolutely. You post some demo on your cell phone.
So this is one of the smallest programs that you can write using the Excel formula language to extract the string between the first two occurrences of underscore. So the user takes this program, runs it, and is happy. But this interaction takes place over a course of days, while what we would like to do is for this interaction to happen in a few seconds. And that is possible if we can automate the role of the expert on the help forum. And this is what we ended up doing. So we built a tool called FlashFill, which is a feature in Excel 2013. And I wonder how many of you have seen, know about FlashFill? Or how many of you do not know about FlashFill and want me to show you a demo of FlashFill? Okay, okay, so let's look at the demo. So here I have a bunch of social security numbers in the first column, and I want to. So what was funny about this? I couldn't hear. Okay. And suppose you want to format them by inserting hyphens. And again, if you are one of those people who do not know programming, 99% of Excel users are in that category, you would have to do it by hand. Right? But now in Excel 2013, so you can do this yourself, all that you have to do is to press Control E. And the system will take the example that you have given, generalize it into a program, and run that program on the remaining rows to automate this task for you.
So does each of those cells in column B now contain a formula based on column A, or do they just contain raw text?
In this particular case, they just contain raw text, but underneath there is a formula that can potentially be exposed and even shown to the user. Now, you might not remember to press this Control E, you know, secret button, or figure out which of these, you know, thousands of features that Excel has, where does this functionality actually lies. So the Excel team actually did quite a good job at avoiding this so-called discoverability issue. So in this case, where I have firstname.lastname@domain.com, suppose I want to extract the last name. And the moment I start trying to do this task for the second row, the system automatically fires this feature. So it gathers that I have a repetitive intent in mind and applies this feature. Now, in general, it's too good to read the mind of the user from just one example, as this scenario would illustrate. So here I have a bunch of medical billing codes, some of which have a right bracket at the end, some of which don't. Suppose my goal is to add a right bracket wherever it is missing. So if I give one example, the system comes up with the simplest generalization, which is to add a right bracket everywhere. So if this is what you wanted, then you are done. But otherwise, you would observe that row 6 to row 10 are incorrect. So I can fix any one of these. And this is like giving a second example to the tool. And now when I press enter, the tool can better converge to the intent that I had in mind. So you can use this for extracting fields out of long strings. All that you have to do is to give an example each. And even if you're a programmer, you will actually end up spending some time to even think about the logic. But so this tool can even be useful for, you know, expert programmers. The tool can actually do quite sophisticated tasks. It can generate loopy programs. So in this case, I may or may not have spaces. I can put periods. I can do lowercase. I can put them in reverse order. It will do it all. So then we, after we published this paper and shipped out this feature, we actually also ended up working on some other sophisticated string transformations. And this was a work that was led by my intern, Rishabh Singh, who is now a colleague at MSR. So the system that is there inside Excel thinks of strings as just a sequence of characters. It does not understand the semantics of numbers and dates. So suppose you want to round off numbers to two decimal places. How would you do this in a language like, you know, Excel or C sharp? So what we'll do? How will you do this in Python and C? Well, this is the elegant way to do it, In Java, this, right? So again, the point that I'm trying to make is that there are lots of simple cases where examples are the most natural way to express intent, and you don't have to unnecessarily memorize these different things. So you can give one or two examples, and the system will try to give you all these format descriptors that are consistent with those examples, and then you can pick one of those. So here is another example that we've found on Help Forum, and this is another thing that we can automate from just, you know, one or two examples. I think in this case, two examples are needed. So now this is a scenario where the task that I want to automate in this table on the right side involves making use of some background knowledge which is present in the tables on the left side. So the user wants to map the product name and the selling date of the product to the selling price of that product. And in order to compute this output, which is not a syntactic transformation of these inputs, the user has to actually take a join of these two tables with respect to the ID column, then index the resultant table with these two values, and then extract markup and price, then do some syntactic transformations on it, like remove the percentage sign, remove the dollar sign, and then combine them as you see in this output column. So in Excel, you'll have to do this using an operator called VLOOKUP, which is the biggest pain point in Excel formulas, as has been, you know, found through different studies. So again, here you can give a couple of examples, and the system will automatically figure out the right transformation for you. So we did a lot of work in this area of doing some string transformations, right? So we went from syntactic string transformations to doing more semantic string transformations. But more generally, in this space of data manipulation, there are lots of interesting transformations that people want to do in order to massage the data that is coming from, let's say, you know, social media, cloud computing, and all of this data is present in a very raw, semi-structured format. But in order to be able to leverage this data that is out there, we need to actually transform and massage this data in a more structured format. So let's actually see what are the different kinds of tasks that you need in this general space of broader space of data wrangling besides string transformations. So you typically start with doing some kind of extraction of the key items that you care about. So let's say you have a web page or you have a log file, you want to extract some relevant bits. Then you might want to do some transformations of the kind I showed you, and then you might want to actually do some formatting transformations in order to prepare the data in a more presentable form. So I've already shown you a demo in this space of, you know, transformation. Now let me actually show you the kinds of tasks that you might want to automate in the other categories. So here is an assignment taken from a data science class run as a MOOC from Brown University. You're given a Wikipedia page that looks like this, and your goal is to extract a structure or CSV format that looks like the one on the right side. And the instructor provides an initial script for the students to build on top of this in order to do this task. Does this sound familiar? Has anyone taken a data science class here? But I hope you can imagine, you know, running into tasks like this. So now I'll show you the experience that we have designed based upon by example interaction to be able to extract such structured data on the right side from the raw semi-structured data on the left side. So I'm going to load that file in this tool, and I'm going to start giving examples of the fields that I want to extract. So one of the fields that I want to extract is, let's say, the championship name. And the moment I give two instances of the championship name, the system tries to learn a script which can figure out more such instances. I can change the color label, and I can try to extract other fields. So in this case, if I give one instance of the year, and that interaction is sufficient for the tool to gather that I want to extract years, I can try to extract other things such as the winning score. And now, as you can imagine, the system does not, you know, did not get it right at this particular place. But I can give one more example, and the system will actually get it right after that. But what if this place where the system made an error occurred somewhere in the middle of a huge document? So this is a place where we need more intelligence from the tool in order to be able to interact with the user, for the user to provide more representative examples, and we'll get into that later.
Tools having trouble telling, like,
So in this particular tool, the only way you can interact with the system initially is by giving examples. And I will show you other forms of interaction you can do, maybe in a few slides. But you can also imagine combining different, you know, modes of interaction. And I truly believe that natural language can be a very complementary way to interact with the system along with examples.
If scores weren't always written with the higher score first, would you be able to still extract like the higher score?
Yes. So let me answer answer this question more generally, right? So what kinds of tasks can one such given PBE technology do, and what kinds of tasks will it not be able to do? Right? The way these technologies work is that there's an underlying domain-specific language, and we try to find programs in this domain-specific language that are consistent with the examples that the user has provided. So if the task that the user wants to do is expressible in this domain-specific language, the system will be able to automate it, if not with two examples, with three examples, or with four examples, and so on. And we try to have a good ranking scheme so that you can do it with fewer examples as opposed to providing more examples. If the task that you want to do is more sophisticated than what is expressible in the domain-specific language, the system will fail and will tell you, sorry, I was not able to automate this task for you. So once we figure out a category of tasks that a lot of people care about, and the current domain-specific language is unable to express those things, the standard exercise that we go through is to extend that domain-specific language to be able to express, allow expression of those kinds of tasks. Now, you might think that why don't we work with a Turing-complete domain-specific language? You know, what's wrong with that? The more expressive the language is, the harder would it be for the tool to search for the right program in that domain-specific language. So it is important to maintain a right trade-off between expressivity and also keeping it simpler enough so that the tool can efficiently search for programs in that language.
It's also important to make sure that you sort of bias the language in such a way that short programs are likely to show up.
Indeed. So we'll actually cover that in more depth. So let me actually move on. Yes. So this work was actually led by Wu Li, who was my student at UC Davis, and now again I'm honored to have him as a colleague in my team at Microsoft. This technology has shipped inside two products, so you can try it out yourself if you have PowerShell installed. And there is a log file analysis product that Microsoft has called Azure OMS, and this also features there as well. So I'll show you my final demo, but in order, before I actually show you that, let me actually motivate a very interesting interaction model that is being talked about by some startups in this space. So Trifecta is one of them. So suppose you have a table that looks like this, and you want to transform it into a structured table that looks like the one on the right side. So one of the very cool things that Trifecta came up with is this model of predictive interaction, where when you are working with such a table, it is going to suggest you some interesting operations that you might want to perform on this table, as opposed to you figuring out which of the 1,000 operations that are there inside Excel do you actually need to invoke. So one of the things that it might suggest you is, do you want to split on the colon delimiter? So maybe if your cursor is in the second column, among other possible operations, it might actually suggest you this. Then once you are at this stage, among other possible operations, it might suggest you if you want to delete empty rows. And maybe you want to fill values down, and maybe then you want to pivot and so on. but here, the user has to be intuitive. They have to have enough intuition that they can actually guess all these intermediate states in order to go from the left side to the right side. Now, what would you imagine a PBE experience around this be like? So in this case, we can actually directly go from the table on the left side to the right side, and all that the user has to do is to give one or two examples of the rows that you see in the table on the right. So let me quickly show you a demo that was actually built by Maxim for this particular domain. So I'm going to show you a different example here. So what I have here is the name of a conference and the top cited authors in that conference, and then this kind of data repeats for different conference occurrences. Suppose I want to figure out who is the most cited author across all these different editions of the conferences. if all of this data was present in one structured table, I can probably write a SQL query in order to be able to answer such queries. But now I'm again stuck in this world where the data is there, but it is in a semi-structured form and not so easy to analyze. So I'm going to tell the tool that I want to make an output table with three columns. The names of these columns don't really matter. And then I'm going to give examples of tuples that should be there in this output table. I'm going to provide another example of a tuple from down below to make it more representative for the tool. And now the tool is going to learn a program which can extract more such entries from the original data and put it in this nice structured format. And now I can write my SQL queries. So we have also invested more into doing table formatting transformations. So again, all of these are real examples taken from help forums. So this is one thing that I would actually, you know, recommend quite strongly to graduate students, that if you want to find interesting, you know, useful problems to work upon, one thing that I gathered was, you know, going and looking at help forums. So the user wants to convert a table that looks like the one on the top to the one that looks like the one on the bottom. And again, giving a small input-output example is sufficient to learn the desired transformation. And these are some other, you know, scenarios that look like that. Just imagine how much time would it take for you, even as a programmer, to be able to write these scripts. And then again, this is a little bit of a laundry list of, you know, various things that we have done in these three areas that I was talking about, which are the integral parts of data wrangling. But let me actually move on now. So as you know, a question that was asked was that what techniques do we have in order to resolve ambiguities that are there in the example-based specification? So we try to use ranking techniques to be able to rank different programs. So the way these tools typically work are that when the user gives a certain number of examples, we generate not one program, but we generate lots of programs in the underlying domain-specific language that are consistent with the examples. And now we want to be able to figure out which of these programs is actually the intended one. And there we use ranking techniques. So for instance, here where I want to extract the first word from this name, suppose if I were to give these two examples, then the second program is actually also a valid program. But I want the first program. So what ranking metric do you think will help me prefer the first program over the second program? It's program length, right? And one way to characterize that is to say that a program that uses few constants, a small number of constants. And now let's say I want to be able to automate this task from just one example, so I just give one example. Then another program that the system can learn would be the third program. So how would I now prefer the first program over the third program? Because the third program is also a very simple program. One way that I would like to characterize that is to say that we prefer smaller constants. So if you were to be able to compare the integer 1 and the string Rishabh, and again going back to this thing about, you know, picking programs with simpler, you know, cosmographic complexity. Okay, but the problem with this approach is that this actually gives you a partial order, not a total order, as we will see in some more sophisticated scenarios like this. So here, this is a real program that I want, second word followed by some space and then the first word. But you can also imagine printing, you know, comparing up this program from just, you know, the first example. Now, the first program has a small constants, but a large number of constants, while the second program has a small number of constants, but the constant itself is, you know, quite large. And the way we resolve this discrepancy is that we assign weights with constants, and these weights are learned using standard machine learning techniques from labeled data. So this is how we apply machine learning today inside our work to rank programs. Yes, so imagine that the user has a data where they want to transform 10 inputs to the right, you know, corresponding 10 outputs, and that's the golden truth. Imagine as if the user only gave one example. So I will end up learning, let's say, 100 different programs, 5 of which might be consistent with the golden truth, and 95 of which may only be consistent with the example that the user provided, but not consistent with the golden truth. I'm going to actually be describing the algorithms for that, you know, after this. Yes. Yeah. So I've not yet described how do we do the learning, right? And there's a lot of, you know, the real technical depth in the work that we have done is actually, you know, lies in that particular part, which I'm going to cover in the last part of the. So here, if I just give one example, the system can come up with a program which says extract the first number or extract the last number. And how would you rank those? In fact, you know, since English is read left to right, my inclination would be to say that the first program should be ranked higher than the second program. But in this case, you want the second program. And if we use the strategy that I was talking about earlier, having weights with the constants, it turns out, you know, both programs have exactly the same constant, so they would again end up having the same score. But in order to resolve conflicts here, you can imagine also looking at the features of the data as opposed to just features of the program. And if you were to execute the first program on this data, you will end up producing 64. But if you execute the second program on this data, you will end up producing 1995. And 64 is less similar to 1993 than is 1995 to 1993. So if you take these features into account, then you can start doing even more fine-tuning of your ranking schemes. And this is how, for instance, we'll be able to get this scenario working from just one example. And it's very important to be able to optimize this thing as strongly as you can. And so for instance, I'll tell you the feedback that Excel team gave us. So initially, the first prototype of Flashville that we wrote used to take 3 to 4 examples on average. And they say there's no way that they can ship such a technology. Because even today, not many people know you can give more than one example. And if the system gives funny interpretations after you give one example, people are going to lose trust, and they're not going to, you know, use your technology. So we really invested into sophisticated ranking techniques before we brought that down to a little bit more like, you know, one example per task on an average, or slightly higher than that. And then the Excel team actually felt quite confident to be able to ship this technology out. So the reason why I'm trying to describe you this particular experience is that these technologies might look cool when you build them as prototypes, but if you really want to deploy them and make it usable, you have to really think about the entire end-to-end story. And in this case, interaction, user interaction, and ranking it makes a lot of difference. Yeah, so I think the message that I wanted to give here was that you want to look at both program features and as well as the features in the data in order to predict which program out of the huge number of programs that are consistent with the examples is the one that the user really intends. So after Flashville got released, this person who is the author of this famous, you know, Excel Bible that keeps getting released with every version of Excel actually sent me a personal note saying that while Flashville is a, you know, a great feature, but you need to be very careful. People, it can actually wreak havoc with financial spreadsheets. People might just not notice when the system does a wrong transformation in one of the rows, and that can be quite catastrophic depending upon how sensitive the spreadsheet was. So what this boils down to is that we need to have a safe a model which will, safe-proof model which will work, you know, in all cases, because ranking may work in most cases, but still there are scenarios where the user might not actually get what they want. So we need to be able to provide more transparency to the user as to what is it that the tool has actually done. So we have various different models that we have experimented with in terms of building rich user interaction with the user. So the model that you have seen in my demos until now is that the user looks at the output. If the output is incorrect, the user provides more representative examples. But we can do much more than this. For instance, we can actually show these programs to the user. And if the user is a non-programmer, we can imagine paraphrasing these programs into English. We can, instead of showing just the top-ranked program, we can show lots of programs that have been synthesized to the user and then let the user select between those different programs. We can also enable an active learning session with the user where we highlight those entries in the computed output where we feel the user probably needs to look more and provide more examples. Or we can ask questions to the user, did you mean this or did you mean that? So let me quickly show you a small demo of some of these rich user interaction models. So in this very scenario, so let's say this mistake was occurring somewhere deep down inside the document, which is not so easy to eyeball. If I go to the disambiguation tab, it actually precisely points out this position and asks me, did I mean 16-7 or did I mean 16? So the ranking here is not good enough, so it didn't get the program right. But it was able to figure out that another top-ranked program, when executed on this data, was producing 16 here. So the highest-ranked program produces 16-7. The next highest-ranked program produces 16. And that it knows is a source of, you know, is a point of discrepancy. And this is what it presents to the user. So this is one of the ways that you can actually do active learning. You can even look at the programs that have been generated. So let's look at the program that has been generated for the blue label. So it says to extract the blue label from the entire text, you take all the lines that begin with this regular expression. So when I hover over this regular expression, I see the matches of it being highlighted on the left side, so I know where exactly it is being matched. And then it says that within this line, you take the string between the last occurrence of the left bracket and the last occurrence of bar, which is very similar to a program that you might have written yourself. So in this case, the programs are being generated in C#, and we are just paraphrasing them in English. And just to show you a little bit more about the other ambiguity resolution model that I talked about, which was ranking, I'll show you, you know, one slide on that. So what do you think I'm trying to do in column B? So let's extract the first letter. And what do you think is happening in column C? First two letters. And what's happening here? First three letters. What do you think I'm trying to do now? So if I showed this to a human, what would you think would a human guess? Okay. So let me clarify. Suppose I didn't do column B, C, D, and I directly tried to do column E, then your most natural interpretation would be it's trying to extract the first word, which it is. But if you really wanted the first four characters, or at most the first four characters, all that you have to do is to give one more example, and then it will do it for you. So this is my favorite one. So what do you think is happening here? And this is what the computer thinks as well. So it's smart enough to figure out that this lowercase f does not come from these lowercases f, because extracting those things from the same character class sequence would have a higher entropy. But it is more likely to be extraction of this capital F and that being downgraded into lowercase. So you can imagine that the ranking is actually quite sophisticated. And if it was not, you will not get a good, you know, user experience. But Excel did not invest into building richer user interaction models, though. They invested more in just having a fancier ranking scheme. So now let me actually get to the real meat of, you know, how this technology works, which is how do you take these examples and generate programs from there. So we have a search algorithm that takes examples and generates program. And as I mentioned earlier, that if you try to search over the state space of all possible programs, this is going to be not effective at all. The search space is too huge. So what we instead try to do is we try to restrict the search to a domain-specific language. And the design of this domain-specific language is an art. You might want to make it expressive enough to cover a wide variety of tasks in the domain that you care about. On the other hand, you want it to be restricted enough to enable efficient search. So now we have reduced the problem from searching over a huge infinity to searching over a small infinity. But still, it's not going to be sufficient by itself. So we need more interesting ways to search in this particular domain-specific language. So the search algorithm that I had in mind was doing brute force search, right? Because the simplest algorithm that you can imagine is to enumerate over all possible programs in this language, starting from programs of a small size. But as I mentioned, that this is a still infinite state space. Our DSLs are typically quite rich, that this strategy is also not going to work. So what we do is we do more interesting search, exploiting the semantics of the operators in these domain-specific languages, and I'm going to tell you about how that looks like in a moment. But let me first show you instances of what these domain-specific languages actually look like. So you saw the demo that I showed about flash fill. What are the operators do you think that you might actually put in such a string manipulation language? So what are the most fundamental string manipulation operators that come to your mind? Okay, concatenation, so that's one. And what is the opposite of that?
Splitting.
Splitting, yes. So our language is really based upon, you know, these two, you know, principles here. So the language generates programs that map a tuple of input strings into an output string. So the multiple input columns, they represent those tuple of strings. At the very top level of this language, we have a conditional operator, because the data might occur in two or three different formats, and you might want to do a different kind of processing for the data that is of a certain kind. So we don't allow arbitrary conditionals, but we allow conditionals only at the very top. And as you rightly observed, that what happens in these branches is we have a concatenate operator. And what do we concatenate? Well, we concatenate substrings of the input string. And the way substring is computed is using an interesting manner. So you specify the starting index of the substring and the ending index of the substring using this position expression P. But this position expression P is quite sophisticated. And it looks like I don't have it on my slide here. So the way that this position expression is specified is using regular expressions. So we use two regular expressions to specify a position expression, with the semantics being that I want that position in the string such that the left side of that position matches with the first regular expression and the right side of that position matches with the second regular expression. And we also have a way to specify which such match it should be. Should it be the first such match or the second such match, and so on. But more or less, you know, the two real key constructs are concatenate operator and substring operator. And there's a little bit of loopy semantics as well, which I have not shown here. So let's take a quick, you know, look at what the language for flash extract, or the tool that I showed you, which was extracting data from log files by examples. So what we do is we unconditionally, you know, split the file into a bunch of lines. So now we are really operating over an array of lines. And then we filter these lines using a filter function. And the filtering can happen based upon logics which say that the line should contain k occurrences of a regular expression r, or it should start with something that matches a regular expression r. We can also filter by virtue of position in the initial array. So you can say I want every fifth line starting with the second line. We can even filter by what happens in the previous line. And then once you filter lines, then we actually take substrings of those lines using the map operator. Or we can compute two different sets of strings and we can merge them together. So you can keep imagining, you know, adding more onto this domain-specific language as you keep observing the kinds of patterns that you need to be able to codify the tasks that you want. But in order to efficiently search for a program in this domain-specific language, you need to be able to specialize the search algorithm to the domain-specific language. So you need to have a very specialized search algorithm for this domain-specific language. And this search algorithm is going to leverage the semantic properties of operators in this language. I will not have time to go into much details, but I will try to just point out the higher level principle that we use in the search algorithm, which is more or less based upon divide and conquer. So what we do is we try to reduce the problem of synthesizing an expression in the grammar, in the domain-specific language, that satisfies a given specification that the user provides, to simpler problems. And simpler problems meaning either you have a problem that talks about a sub-expression of E, or you talk about sub-constraints that occur in the specification phi. And then you combine the results and you put them together to generate the solution. So I'll illustrate this by means of an example. So recall the task of extracting, let's say, I didn't show this demo though, but in this case I want to extract the list of cities from this log file. And the flash extract grammar, if you recall, looks like computing a bunch of lines from the original file and then filtering them using some filter function and then taking a substring of those lines. So more or less, you know, this is the essence of the flash extract grammar. So the specification that the user has provided is saying that I want to take this particular input, and on this input I want to generate a list whose first two elements are the highlighted ones. So this is the specification that the user has provided. Now this specification for T, I want to reduce it to a specification for L and S. So this is my divide and conquer principle, where I'm trying to solve a sophisticated problem by reducing it to simpler problems. So recall what L and S are, right? So L actually represents lines in this file, and S is the function that extracts substrings from those lines. So what do you think will be the specification for L? What should, if T is to evaluate to this list that starts with these two yellow highlighted entries, what should L evaluate to? Yes, you are right. So L should actually evaluate to this entire line. And what should be the behavior of S? The behavior of S should be that in the string Redmond comma WA, it should extract Redmond. So recall S is a substring function that we are trying to learn. And on the string Renton comma Washington, it should evaluate to Renton. So now essentially what we have converted, generated is an inverse of this operator. So I knew something about the output of map, and what I am able to do is to figure out what the value of L and what the value of S should be. And this is the kind of idea that I keep recursively using in order to reduce the specifications to simpler specifications, and then I get to base cases. So let me just do one more, you know, iteration here. So let's see, you know, what will happen if I recursively try to reduce the problem for S here. So my goal is to generate a substring expression that when run on this entire string will generate the yellow part as the output. So what do you think is the specification for P1 and P2? What should P1 and P2 evaluate to so that the substring function returns me Redmond on this entire string? That reasoning will actually happen in the layer below. So P1 and P2 are just integer expressions here. So all that you have to say is that P1 should evaluate to 0 and P2 should evaluate to 7. And now when you recursively go and see what should R1, R2 be such that, you know, P2 evaluates to 7, then you will actually say it should be before a comma and after a comma and so on. So this is how we keep exploiting inverses of functions in order to map the problem of synthesizing a higher level program into synthesizing smaller programs. So this is a very systematic way of searching for programs, and this is what seems to scale for the kinds of domains that we deal with, as opposed to using more brute force search or heuristic based search. So this is
But this specific way you're doing divide and conquer is specific to the domain specific language.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So all these algorithms are very specific to the domain specific language. So it takes us probably like a week, at least for me, a week to design the domain specific language with my experience. But it would take me 1 man-year to develop a system which is as robust as the one that you saw I was trying to demo. 1 man-year. This is exactly what I wanted to talk about. So you flowed me into what I want to talk about. So developing a domain-specific programming by example solution that works well requires domain-specific insights. It requires good engineering that only some people in this room can do. And if you want to extend the DSL, it is going to be a very difficult task, because now you have to go and change and make, you know, all changes in your implementation. So now we want to lower the barrier of developing such tools. And this is critically important because we want to be developing lots of programming by example tools for lots of domains. We want to do sorting by example. We want to do grouping by example, filtering by example, parsing CSV files by example, parsing web pages by example, number transformations by example, date transformations by example. And you cannot spend 1 year building each such technology. So we really have to bring down the cost of this development. And the way we bring that down is by some critical observations that Alex had, which is to refactor the divide and conquer strategy, which was common to all these different algorithms. And it turns out that the reduction, how you reduce the specification for a particular operator, just depends upon the logical properties of that operator. So these different properties of operators can be again captured in a modular fashion, so that if different DSLs use the same operator, you don't have to do anything for that. This intelligence is already captured in the framework, and you can just use it directly. So this is the framework that actually Alex built. And I was just interviewing a team member and asked him about his experiences working with the framework versus developing a point solution. And he told me that what would have taken him 3 months, now with the framework took him 8 days, which I think was a big accomplishment. So now our architecture actually looks like this. We have a generic search algorithm, which is parameterized by a domain-specific language. And as long as you are using those operators for which we have already implemented the reduction strategy, you don't have to do anything. You just have to write a domain-specific language. And the search algorithm will be automatically generated for you. So this experience you can liken to that of developing a parser. So you use tools like Yak and Bison, and you don't necessarily have to implement these recursive descent algorithms like LL1, LR1 parsing algorithms. This technology is very well understood, has been packaged inside frameworks, and all that you do is to enjoy playing with different context-free grammars for the language for which you want to write a parser for. So this SDK we now call Prose, and it has been released publicly for non-commercial purposes. You're welcome to look it up and download, play with it. Prose stands for Program Synthesis Using Examples, and when we also start doing natural language-based interaction, we'll make it stand for Program Search. So this is the team. I think there are a few more members who have joined whose names is not yet there, but you know, Alex, I'm very grateful to him for being a key member of the team here. So now, before concluding, I will actually leave you with two important details here. You might actually see the buzzword, you know, deductive synthesis and inductive synthesis in the synthesis literature quite a bit. So deductive synthesis refers to synthesizing using deductive methods. And this work has mostly been applied for synthesizing programs from logical specifications, right, as opposed to example-based interaction. While inductive synthesis refers to synthesizing from example-based specifications, and various different kinds of techniques have been applied to doing inductive synthesis. But what we do is, so these two things are actually orthogonal. They are not like, you know, either this or that. So we actually do deductive synthesis from inductive specification. So this is how I would actually characterize this line of work. The final thing that I want you to actually also be able to explain, if someone asks you, what is the difference between machine learning and programming by examples? Again, this is a little bit more of a higher level and naive perspective, but maybe something that you might find illuminating. So machine learning, traditional machine learning, requires too many examples for training. While, as you can see, that the final artifact that we have just works with one or two examples. It's a different matter that we use machine learning to learn the ranking functions, but that happens in an offline phase. On the other hand, machine learning might generate models which might not always make sense to humans, but we generate models which are human readable and editable. We are generating programs. We can explain these programs in English to the user. On the other hand, our techniques are very limited to those tasks for which you can actually write a deterministic program that will work 100% of the time the way you intend it to be. Whereas machine learning techniques can solve much more complicated problems where you are aiming for high precision but not necessarily 100% accuracy, and they can also handle noise in the input data. So these are techniques that are meant for very different kinds of tasks. Right? So what we are doing here is generating small programs for relatively simple tasks. But we do that very well using our deductive techniques. There's a huge opportunity to combine the complementary strengths. We can imagine generating probabilistic models or probabilistic programs which can handle noise in the input data. I also talked about how we are using machine learning in generating ranking functions, and I'm sure you folks might be able to figure out other synergies in this area. But these are two very complementary fields, I would say. So this is my concluding slide, the same slide that I showed you earlier. I'll stop here and would be happy to take any questions, further questions you might have.
So in the differences between programming by example and traditional machine learning, the second point you made was that the models had to be explainable. And of course, I think everybody likes explainable models, but I guess my question would be with FlashFill or the other tools you fielded, how often does somebody look at the model?
So FlashFill, this thing was not released. And even if this capability of showing the Excel formula was released, unfortunately, we didn't have the telemetry information to get this data back. We have just started doing some user studies where we gathered that users actually preferred not looking at the different programs that we generated, but the behavior of that of those different programs on the input data that they had.
Right, which was, I think, your last line. So do you take it back, the second line?
I would actually say that those studies were not exhaustive. And there are settings where looking at the programs and having full trust would be very critical. For instance, imagine a setting where you want to run this script on gigabytes of data using clusters of machine. In that case, you don't want to unnecessarily spend computational resources until you have inspected the program more carefully. So there might be settings where either would be useful.
Thank you. Why don't we take further questions after the talk? Thanks so much.
Thanks.